All right. So last week we were looking at page 15 in the spirit of prophecy, and it started with Revelations 19 and 10. And I'm not going to go there. I'm just going to remind you guys also you can look at the wedding supper in Matthew 22, 11, and 14. If you didn't read over in your books, I think it's imperative that if you're in this here discussion and meeting that you read and study the scriptures, because it's a powerful teaching that brings us closer to who we are. John 3 and 23 was brought up. It's John 3, 23 and 33. Let's see, it says, as we went on, prophetic revelation. Now, the author is stating in regards to prophetic revelation, glory to God, she says, now we're not saying that the prophet is in an elevated state above the other gifts, but in fact, the prophet or the prophetic is in front of the rest. And the reason for that is because the prophet points the person or the people in a direction. It's wonderful, and it's a wonder how when we prophesy, and some of us believe that we can't or we're not, I'm just going to give you some revelation of that, that we actually show people a direction and course. And that's even in salvation. If you find yourself getting involved in the in-depthness of salvation and pointing people in the direction of freedom, you'll find that the prophet in you is actually doing that, because there's a lot of ministries that actually fall short or forget what Jesus' teaching was really about, and it was about freedom, all right? Freedom to move into the truth of who you are, because we're actually remembering. It's not that we didn't have this. We're remembering who we are. And so it says, if we look at all gifts, whether teaching, healing, evangelizing, they can all flow through one another. And this is true. They connect. But remember, the Father will do nothing without first revealing it to his prophets. And that is, if you ever had an understanding of what your purpose is, and God gave it to you, even if a prophet spoke it to you, he will not do anything before he reveals it to the prophet. So, therefore, there is a need for the prophet, because even with the prophet, P-O-R-F-I-T, he profits the people. She profits the people. Because if the people listen to the prophet, then they're able to find the next step if they're stuck. Amen? So we must understand that we're not to pray for someone unless the Lord, unless led by the Lord, if we do, when it's just a work. Okay, so this author believes somewhat like me. I want to explain this here, because sometimes we've prayed for people and we should not have. Example, and I don't want you guys to think that this is like a nasty rendition of a situation that I experienced, but my mother-in-law does not like me or my husband or our children. But I was so on fire for God at a time in my life that when she was sick, I looked away from her feelings towards me. And I went on and prayed for her because of the love of God, you know. But I felt that it was not right afterwards, because I took her condition on. And the Lord spoke to me and said, I did not tell you to pray for her nor put your hands on her. So we have to be wise and about God's business when we're praying for people and laying hands on, because you're called as a prophet or whatever your ministry is does not mean that you were called to pray for them. Amen. And some people might have a problem with that, but you can go into the Bible and we go into the Pool of Bethesda, and the author begins to talk about this. She says, how many disabled people were at the Pool of Bethesda, yet it only records that Jesus healed one. 1. Even then it states that the work of Christ were too many to write. It was too many to write, but everyone wasn't healed in the time of Jesus. The people and the area that he came from didn't believe in him. Some of those people were not healed because of their faith, and some were not healed because it was God's problem. It was his wishes that they weren't. Maybe it was something they had to walk through. I think that if we take into consideration that everything is not the way that we think it should be, if we walk according to the scriptures, then we'll get a better understanding of how God wants us actually to walk in ministry, and that sometimes when you lay your hands on people, you can pick up something that you won't be able to release. And so it brings us to a place of understanding that we actually have to be like David again and begin to pray and ask God, is this something that I need to pray for? Jesus said to pray for your enemies, but you know what I find when I study the scriptures, he didn't say how this was to be done. Any questions?
Probably. Yes. Oh, what page you on?
I'm on. You should be on page actually 15, and I'm speaking out of the bottom of the page where it says prophetic revelation.
Okay, because my Kindle don't have no page number.
Okay, your Kindle doesn't. Okay, so look at prophetic. See if you can find John 3. And 23, you would be below the spirit of prophecy, Revelation 19 and 10. Go down and you'll see prophetic revelation. Can you find it?
Okay, I see John 3:32 and 33.
Right, okay, I may have said it wrong. Okay, go on, because it talks about the seal where... he that have received the testimony.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, and so you're going to go on down and you'll see prophetic revelation.
Okay.
All right.
Got
and
it.
So she's explaining this, and that, you know, this can be for anybody. This is like you study and show yourself approved. This is not something, when I teach that you have to take my word for it, we all have accounts with God in our relationship, intimacy. We have also, as Romans speaks of, level to level and glory to glory. With level to level and glory to glory, we learn more and we earn more. When we learn, we earn knowledge and revelation. But if we do not apply ourselves to study and really see what the Spirit is saying behind the Word, this is where we fall short. You see, a lot of people think that they fell short when they backslid, or they fell short when they made a mistake, but falling short has to do with depending on others. See, God calls us to study for ourselves, and I advocate study for yourself, because how can you follow a man or a woman? You can't do that. You're only following the man or woman into leadership for your own leadership. You know, there's no one that is not called to be a leader. There's some that will not take the responsibility. And that goes into a whole different realm. But when we look at and when we're working with people, I believe in leadership, because there's a great work to do. If you're on the East Coast and I'm on the West and there's a North and a South, you know, we expand through leadership. And some will say, well, everybody's not a leader. That's because they have not believed in themselves enough to identify with the leader in them. As we breathe the Ruach breath, so is there the gift of God that lives within us. For Jesus said, the kingdom of God is within you. He didn't say some, he said it's within you, which means I take it personal. How about you, right? Okay, so in all of that, when you look at the healing process and the prayers of the righteous avail as much, look at some of the things that we may not look at, which is Why are people calling me to pray for them when they have the ability to pray as well? See, your prayer power extends and you become stronger in prayer when you're made to pray. I didn't learn how to pray from somebody teaching me. I learned how to pray in the trials and tribulation because no one was there for me. So I get it when the prophet is speaking in this book as she's teaching that we are not called to pray for everybody because God will also make people feel that they are isolated when he's setting them apart. When he's isolating you, it seems as if no one is there. And that's a reason for no one to be there because how can you depend on God if everyone is there for you? You can't. You'll keep looking to man for everything, and your dependency will not be alone on God alone. It will not be an independent or intimate relationship. You see, when you get married, wherever you are, you tend to depend on your husband. There's no men on tonight or wives, if you know, when we put the recording out. That is not the whole formula for Christians and leaders. The whole formula goes like this here, that God is my first love. That's why he called Ephesus, the church of Ephesus, and he told them, I love you and I know that you were my first love and I was, but you've forgotten the things about me. You see, when we fall in love with man or woman, we tend to forget about God. Some people will say, well, that's not my problem. Okay, maybe not now. Just be aware at some point in time that love can be deceptive because the first thing that God calls us to, and a man more than anything, according to the Bible, is that he should love the church because a man that loves the church will know how to love his wife. Now, when we turn it around, a woman that loves the church, a woman that's become a servant to God, she will know how to love others. If she doesn't know automatically, she's going to gain ground with it through the trials and tribulations. Many people are wondering why the suffering. Listen, the flesh will not submit to God without suffering. I wish that it would. And I wish that everybody on the line had never had to go through any hardship or pain, but I guarantee there's no better lesson to learn or to take the blinders off of us in our hearts than the suffering times. Now, I'm not praying that on anybody. I'm speaking what's true because Paul even said this suffering cannot compare to the glory. Why? Because it was a thorn that was reminding him to stay in line with God. He had had a situation that kept him reminded of how to stay abound and abased. He had become a bondservant to God, no longer to the flesh, because we're bound by something in this life. It's either going to be to the flesh or it's going to be to God. Well, Paul, through his destructive times, he chose God. And this is where we are. We say we choose God. That's why we're here learning. But when you choose God, your relationship with God is not about depending on man or woman. It's not even about depending on man or woman to pray for you, nor is it prophesying, because I believe, just like God taught me, that we are to align people to understand themselves and to meet with God in that sanctified place, that sanctuary that lives within them, the kingdom that Jesus was talking about. Amen? So, if you come on and you haven't studied, shame on you, because this is your life, and it's your spiritual life, and your spiritual life supersedes your material, physical life. All of it supersedes. So I'm taking a class on leadership, and before we get into the scriptures, on the next page, if you need to find it in your Kindle, if you have Kindle and it does not show you the page numbers like Sherry, the next part that we'll be going into is fill in exercise, and it says spirit of prophecy. Read each of these verses, all right? So I'm studying this book, and it says 25 marriages or 25 surprising marriages. And the author, he goes into talking about different men of God from maybe the 15th century up until now that have served with missionary work, churches over in Europe and, you know, as they began to build America. And one of the wonderful things is that he's talking about their marriages and their families. And so we, in this book, he gives understanding of how they fell short of God's work or how they fell short of their marriages, which is really, to me, is super. Because when we work in marriage, I mean, in ministry, a lot of people don't understand the balancing beam that we have, the juggling effect, you know. But there's a lot there because it's actually grooming us, and it's also telling a story about our hearts. So I read these stories about three or four different men, and one guy was like Billy Graham back in the mid-1800s to early 1900s. His wife was very influential in his ministry, but she and he allowed other people to take care of their children. And in the midst of that, the legacy that he was building as a super evangelist, because they said millions of people were brought to Christ at that time, his name was Billy Sunday, they neglected their children, and their children turned out to be drunkards, and, you know, a few of them were killed. They had horrible marriages. And so we asked ourselves in the midst of these trainings and what we're learning, where is our family? Where is the husband and where is the wife? Where is the family in this? Well, if we look in Deuteronomy 5, what we'll find is the word, or 6, go into Deuteronomy 6, you can write it down. The word of God tells us how important family is. And then when you go into Paul's teaching in Corinthians, Paul tells us how important charity is. So charity first starts at home, because God can do nothing with us until we get our homes in order. And the catalyst from there is that after we have worked with Christ in us and the love, agape love, begins to flourish, he begins to, into the family, he begins to move us out into community. Now, it is according to what your calling is and your purpose, but when you look at the formula, what you see is that you can never, ever really work greatly or do an effective work without Christ first dealing with your heart, and that's your intimate relationship with him, and then your family. So your love is going to overflow from God, and then it's going to be a domino effect into your family. You're going to, the light is going to bring them into salvation if they've not been touched, and then it's going to touch your communities. Amen? So what does this have to do with the prophetic? Well, the prophetic is love, because on the prophets and the law, the commandment of love your neighbor or love everybody hung. See, we can't forget what Jesus said concerning the commandment of love. And that's what's going to bring us into the understanding of ourselves concerning our spiritual fortification. The number one thing that we must have is love. Prophets, they walk in love. I know that some don't, but if I'm teaching it, I'm going to over bear you with love and understanding. You look up the scriptures. If you begin to speak the scriptures on love, God will begin to enter in, and he'll begin to give you that experience of love, because the number one thing that we're here in the earth realm to do is to love. You see, all of, as I was studying all day today, the Spirit said to me, you know that there's going to be an increase of killing. Not enough killing already. And I said, well, Father, what should we do? Well, at this point, I'm going to still keep praying because I know that prayer, you know, it availeth much, you know. And in 1 Corinthians, he says, you know, when you pray, that he will come. I mean, that's Chronicles. Healing. Pray healing. Pray the blood of Jesus over things. Believe what you're saying will come to pass. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. When you're praying, and believe that the words that you speak for our nation is going to come to pass, because it's not that we're in a place that can't be changed, but we're in a place that has to go through a process. It's the same as us in ministry. In order for the world to come into divine alignment, there's a process, because we've had rulers that have not acknowledged God. And so we're in a process, and he will tell his prophets what is to come, but he'll also tell the people about what they should do. And that's all in the Bible. So the spirit of prophecy was called the testimony of Jesus. We talked about that last week. And the reason why the spirit of prophecy became Jesus' testimony is because everything that was written in the Bible until Christ went to the cross was prophetically fulfilled. You should write down fulfilled. Because if things are fulfilled, that means that the word of the Lord is true. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Glory to God. He says, my cup overfloweth, but my cup cannot overflow without something given to the cup to fulfill it. So his cup, his body, overflowed with the oil of the anointing in order for the yokes on our lives to be broken. Some people would say, well, I don't see the anointing. I don't know it. It's spiritual. Although we have the symbolicness of the oil being poured over us at ceremonies, it's a symbolic anointing, but a spiritual anointing that comes to pass through Christ. Because Jesus on the cross released his spirit, which was God, the Christ in him. And that's where the prophetic testimony came forth. Is there any questions? So all of this that he did and all that God wants for us is to be spiritually prepared and understand that the prophecy is coming to pass. What is the prophecy? Some of us have prophecies over our lives. Some of us don't understand what the prophets have spoken and said because they don't, you know, we don't see it. But because we don't see it does not mean that God negates what he's spoken over our lives. Because Jesus had not seen the prophecy in full effect. It was written in the Bible, or in that time, the Bible hadn't even been written because they found scrolls, all right? So the prophecies had been spoken over the man of God that would come, Jesus Christ. His name was written from Isaiah, the Old Testament. You know, they spoke of what would happen, so to speak. Amen? Let me go to Isaiah 59 so I can show you. God bless. Thank you. My computer ain't shut down. So, I don't want to read the whole chapter, but it's a wonderful chapter that relates to what God is saying to Isaiah regarding the people. And he says, behold, the Lord's hand. This is Isaiah. Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither his ear heavy that it cannot hear. All right? And so he is testifying because God has spoken this to him. He also believes it. And 2 says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God. See, your iniquities, your sins, anybody that you witness to, whatever it is that they're focusing on rather than God, has separated them from God. So the prophet goes on and says, and your sins have hid his face from you. So if you forget about God and your concentration is on your bills or on your car or on somebody else or on your dislike towards someone, something that someone has did, guess what? It becomes an idol God to you, all right? And you're focusing on the wrong thing. It causes separation that he will not hear. For your hands are defiled with blood. He goes on to say, your fingers with iniquity, your lips have spoken lies, your tongue have muttered perverseness. Now, you guys can go on and read this, and some people might get afraid when God and you know, Isaiah is talking like this, or Jeremiah, but these were major prophets. And they were prophesying warnings, but they were also prophesying where we are right now. Obscurity. You know, if there's nothing that can be done, God was telling them at this point in time, because now it's just a process. I've told them to honor me. I've told them to see me. And the prophet is telling the people what is going on, why this has happened. The people have had deaf ears. They didn't want to hear, even like in this time. And they didn't hear God, even though they saw, listen to this, the killings and the murders. The people that were running the countries, the government, they didn't believe in God. They were not hearing what these men of God were saying. They kept on. You know, people like Nebuchadnezzar, who had to wind up going into the fields and graves like a beast because he dishonored what God was saying to Daniel. Amen? Here we go. I'm going to the bottom because I don't want to stay here. But I want you to see what God is saying after all of that, because you can go back and you can read it yourself. 16 says, and he saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no intercessor. See, we got to talk about some intercessors right now. Therefore, his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness, it sustained him. See, without an intercessor, effective intercessors, kingdoms fall down. That's where your churches are right now. Effective intercessors that are not fleshly, but they are in the mind of Christ. They're praying endlessly. Why? Because it is a need to pray endlessly. That's why we have all of this stuff going on. There was a time when prayer was taken effectively over our country. Our community stood up together with one another. All right? We got to come back to that. And see, this time that we're in is calling us back. Now, this is prophetic because God has talked to many of us about it. God is calling the people back to him. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray, then will I hear from heaven. Glory. I will hear from heaven then. If my people, well, who are the people? Who are the people? I would say we are the people. We believe. We're gathered. You know, we're talking about what God is saying, that God lives in us, but we have to believe and we have to begin to spread the word. Because, see, what prophets do, again, is go and point people in the direction of salvation, freedom, and liberation. So if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, intercessors, worshipers, and, you know, prophetic vessels have that ability in them. They have intercessory and they have worship in them. We have to tap into those areas of our lives. Don't say, how can I do it? You begin to pray. And you begin to pray earnestly. God is going to give you that feeling in your heart that's going to birth that worshiper and that intercessor. Why? Because he needs people on the wall right now. God can't do anything without using our bodies. That's why we're here. So if anybody had ever said, oh, I'm just here because, wrong, you were created for the master's use. I am created for the master's use. How do other people believe that they're created for the master's use? By the light shining in those that have found him as he is to use them. By the light shining through us. That means that our love walk, we got to talk to ourselves and say, hey, what do I need to change about myself? Because this thing is serious. You know, children are being killed. We got generations. Glory to God. Not just mine. You know, intercessors and worshipers, intercessors, period, begin to cry. They begin to cry out because they feel what's happening. They see in the streets what's going on with the people. They begin to cry. Their heart is pulled on by God. What can I do more, God? Because he's pulling them. Why? Because that's what you're called for. You're not here for your bills. You're not here for your children alone. You see, you belong to the king. That means you got kingdom work to do. How can we do it effectively? By seeing and believing, because most people don't do what they're called to do because they don't believe. They don't believe. And then we go to church and we sit on the pews and we say, my God is an awesome God. But when we leave, we got all the troubles and concerns back. That is not God. Pray over yourself. Prophesy over yourself. Because that is not God. God has called us to do some things. We're not short of it. Isaiah just said it. The only thing just separates us from God is our issues. Glory. The issues. Jesus. The issues. So he goes on to say, For he put on righteousness as a breastplate and helmet of salvation upon his head. And he put on the garments of vengeance for clothing and was clad with zeal as a cloak. And zeal is a strength and energy that God has given. 18 says, according to their deeds, accordingly he will repay fury to his adversaries. See, God is speaking through the prophet now concerning the adversary. Who is the enemy? It's not ours. He is an enemy to God. The enemy is an enemy to God. Even when we're out of line with God, we become God's enemy because we're not living righteously or we're not making righteous choices. You know, like even some people don't believe or don't understand how debt has weighed them down, but it's because they had no idea that God had given them wealth. The power of wealth. He never gave us lack. He never gave us the ability to be poor. We came here with situations. And we took on situations. You see how easy it is to be influenced into something? Maybe our parents may have came, they were in poverty. And so because we saw that, we began to walk in the same light. So God had never caused us to poverty, but whatever poverty we had, believe it, that we have the ability to change it. You see, this is the problem. People do not see that they have the power to change what they were born into. Some people stay the same. Some people don't even believe they can do anything because oppression has been such a heavy weight on them. Some people have egos and they don't want to change. Why? Because the ego is telling them that that's not going to work for you. That their stuff that they're teaching it over there, that's not going to work. How can the Bible tell you? Listen, the Bible is full of wealth, revelation, knowledge, and wisdom. I'm telling you myself because I came from a poor family, poverty, living in the projects. But this Bible has given me a wealth of knowledge that I did not study. He called me to the words. So I guarantee you, if your heart is ready, he says, when the student is ready, the teacher will appear. You have to ask yourself, am I ready? Because the teacher is the Spirit of God. I'm here. I'm pouring in, reminding you. God is relevant in our lives. He's relevant in others' lives because that's what we're here for. Love conquered a multitude of sin. Some people think that sin has to do with relationships, you know, having sex before marriage. And this is true. We don't want to be yoked and entangled to see a kind of thing. But we have so many other areas of sin that we need to communicate to people. So people go to church and they're looking for the preacher to preach them out of their issues. Guess what? It's not going to happen. Listen, God is a miracle worker, and there's an anointing. Some believer will take that word and they will see a miracle happen because by faith they reached and grabbed that word for themselves. But what happens to the one that's going every Sunday and they say, oh, Lord, I've been praying about this here. Yeah, you know, when are you going to take it? He said, I never gave it to you. That's the number one thing. Do you understand? Now, when I get you out of debt and I pay your bills off, what are you going to do? Are you going to learn something different or are you going to go back? Because, listen, behaviors don't change because God has given us a miracle. It don't change because God has spoken a word of declaration into our life. The things change because our consciousness changed and we transformed to become somebody new in Christ. Christ didn't have debt. He didn't even have a house. That's just an area that I'm just kind of like looking at because, you know, a lot of people are in debt, but it's a social thing. And we got to get our people out of these here areas. We got to get them out of the place, you know, where we believe that it's okay to create debt. Because who's going to get us out of the debt? Well, I look to God now. And sometimes, you know, I put myself in debt so far that I feel like Joseph, I'm in a pit. And I'll prophesy my way out. Yes, yes, I'll prophesy my way out. But when I prophesy my way out, listen, when God has paid it off and the miracle has come, listen, he did it for me. But I'm telling you, I stretched in the word and I spoke it over my situation. Guess what? Somebody didn't teach me was not to get out of it. But guess what? God came in the nick of time. He said, don't put yourself in that position again. So I began to teach people. See, God is not, he's given us the power to obtain wealth, Deuteronomy 8 and 18. But we got to see that and begin to teach our children and our families about this here. No more debt. Debt cancellation, yes. 15 and 2 of Deuteronomy, we speak over the people. Okay, any questions before I go on to read this here? No questions. Okay. So he says, according to their deeds. Now remember the key word is deeds. Accordingly, he will repay fury to his adversaries. I mean, your deeds in debt is going to repay you. And God don't have to do nothing there because I'm telling you, when you in over your head, that's enough beating a hey. Than anything. God is just watching in most cases and people are blaming God for doing things. He allows us. Because we choose, and we have free will. We even have free will to get in these relationships with these men and women. You know how abuse is, you know, on the forefront, children and so on and so forth. God allows it because it's called to turn the person around. We need to minister to these people. Tell them about the salvation of Christ, and there is no abuse in Christ. That is the enemy. That is a world situation. If you're in an abusive situation or your friends and they're in Christ, you got to help them to understand. Not browbeat them, but give them scripture. Christ didn't abuse anybody he loved. All right? So he says, to the islands he will repay recompense. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun. When the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against them. And that's a scripture you can use and prophesy. So when I see the enemy coming in, you look like you're trying to flood. No, the Spirit of the Lord has lifted a standard against you. I decree. No, the Spirit of the Lord. And if I can't say anything else, I keep repeating the same thing because it's a prayer when I prophesy. You know? Some people are looking for expedient, elaborate prayers. That's not what God is looking for. He just says, speak and declare my word. And the Redeemer shall come to Zion and unto them that turn from transgression. Turn away in Jacob, says the Lord. Put Psalms 85 down and begin to read it. And speak it. And so 21 was the powerful part that I read. He says, as for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. My spirit that is upon thee and my words which I put in your mouth shall not depart out of thy mouth. Now you just pay attention to that. Because as for me, this is my covenant with them, says the Lord. Who is them? His people, his children. My spirit that is upon thee. So the spirit of the Lord is upon thee. And my words which I have put in thy mouth shall not depart out of thy mouth. Now get it. Nor out of the mouth of thy seed. Nor out of the mouth of thy seed. See, so you got generations that are taken care of with this word of God. You got generations from you to your grands to your great grands. And even if you don't have them now, that you're speaking life for them to change situations right now. And he says, from henceforth and forevermore. But you know what happens is that people allow the troubles, as Isaiah began to speak earlier, to separate them from the word of God. And this here, 21, as for me, this is my covenant. God has given a blessing. My spirit that is upon thee, because we believe so much what is going on in the world or the adversary or the situation. We believe in that more than the word. We're not speaking the word of God. He says, the words I put in your mouth. I gave you a book to speak. I gave you a book that you can declare. But you choose to continue to say what the world has said to you and what it showed you. When will my people change? When will my people humble themselves and see what thus says the Lord or speak what thus says the Lord? So he says, I put in thy mouth shall not depart. It shall not depart. See, in Proverbs, he says, out of the heart flow the issues of life. And we have to see what issues do we have in our heart. Because whatever the issues are in our heart, we're blocking what truly could come to us. Sometimes we just believe that it shall be. Listen, I done cried about a lot of things, but I still got up and I said, it's all about God. It's the Lord. Why? Because no one could take me out of hell but God. Not no man, not no friend. When I owe homage to man and to friend, when I know that I've been at death's gate, nobody but the Lord. My devotion and my diligence is to him. Why? Because no one can do what God has done in my life. Now, whatever you walked through and whatever you saw, whatever hurt and pain, whatever experience, no one could heal you but God. And that covenant agreement is established by the Spirit and his word. The covenant agreement is established through our relationship with him, where two or three of us are gathered. In the beginning, God created man. He created him for his own use. He said, let us make man. You're not your own. He's given us words to speak in our lives rather than this here, you know, oh gosh, where am I at? Sometimes you see horror and conflict in your family because God is trying to prompt you to speak over their lives, not to take in what you see. We are spiritual beings. We see in the spirit, not the natural. As long as I see in the natural, I'm going to be in the same conflict that Isaiah talked about in this the beginning of the first two scriptures. So here, any questions? I'm going to begin to close up, and I'm going to go through these scriptures, that are of spiritual and prophetic application. It's 1 Corinthians 1, 5 through 7. And Paul is saying here that in everything you are enriched by him in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ. Well, in our application, you know, we are called to put the spirit of prophecy. Why? Because the spirit of prophecy was confirmed in us by Jesus' testimony. And can anybody tell me what Jesus' testimony was? Okay, Revelations 19, could you guys go to Revelations 19, please?
You say Revelations 19?
Yes, ma'am.
I've got it. What scripture did you want?
I'm going to read it.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Yeah. It says, and I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said to me, see not, I am your fellow servant and of your brothers that have testimony of Jesus. The angel says, worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So what is the testimony of Jesus?
What verse did you read? Or are you just reading it?
Revelations 19 and 10.
Okay. What was his you said what was his testimony?
Yes.
Worship God?
No. The spirit of prophecy is the testimony.
Oh.
All right.
Testimony of Jesus is. Okay, I'm sorry. It's right there in my face. Okay.
Okay, thank you. That's great. So in 1 Corinthians 1, 5 and 7, it says that in everything you are enriched by him, in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ. And this is Paul. This is the scripture. You could look it up. And the testimony of Christ is the spirit of prophecy. And the author of the book that we're studying out of, what she does is she's lining up the evidence and the information to help us to build on the fact that the spirit of prophecy is confirmed in us, right? So even as the testimony of Christ, the spirit of prophecy, she says, fill in the exercise. The prophetic application, the spirit of prophecy is revealed and confirmed in me. The next scripture is 1 Corinthians 2 and 1. And I, brothers, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. This is what Paul is saying in this scripture. And the testimony of God is the spirit of prophecy. Because Revelations 19 and 10 tells us that Jesus' testimony was the spirit of prophecy. All right? Revelations 1 and 2 and 9, it says, who bear record of the word of God and of the testimony of Jesus Christ, and it was the spirit of prophecy and of all things that he saw. 9, I, John, was also, who also am your brother and companion in tribulation and in kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos. For the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ, the testimony is the spirit of prophecy. The testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. The testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit of prophecy because Jesus went on the cross. And when he died, the fulfillment of the word over his life and what was to come took place. Revelation 6 and 9. And when does anybody object? Let me ask that. Do we understand?
I'm trying to get it. I'm listening.
Okay, the testimony of Jesus Christ. What is a testimony? See, I talked about this here last week. What? Let's get somebody to tell us what a testimony is.
A testimony is something that you went through and you share that something had happened out of. Like, for instance, something bad you were going through and you're sharing how you got through it.
Okay. So, in Jesus having a testimony, what would you say his would be?
How he healed, delivered, or how he overcame through what he, you know, through his ministry. You know, He had a lot going on, you know, people, you know, against him and, you know, some things he had to go through if you read about the story about Jesus. And I guess he can share how he overcame those things and how he even went fast and how the devil tempted him in the 40-day fast. And that could be a share of a testimony.
Okay, so let's go a little bit further because you're right there and you're right. But where was the fulfillment of what he was supposed to do? Where was it at? Where did it take place?
Where did it take place?
Mm-hmm. See, this is why it's good to interact, because she's going to get it. Because she's thinking. She's interacting with the question. And what we find is we don't understand, a lot of people don't understand what the cross was for. Get out of Bushata. So the cross, he was crucified, right?
Right.
Where did he have his, he told them what was coming, right, at this Last Supper. Let's just fast forward. So he spoke.
Right, he shared with the disciples.
Exactly, all right. So when he was sharing, he was prophesying.
Okay, right.
He was speaking what was to come, not to mention that Isaiah and all of them back in the Old Testament had talked about this.
So he fulfilled the prophecy from the Old Testament.
That's right. He fulfilled his life purpose, but it was spoken before the foundation of the earth.
Okay.
So when he talked to his disciples, he began to prepare them. Why was he training them? Let's talk about that.
Training the disciples?
Oh, I'm sorry. So they could share the word?
Exactly. Good. And what is the word for? Sherry, hold on to your thought.
The word was to save others or to bring others closer to God.
Right. Okay. So if the word was to save others and bring others closer to God, what would Jesus being crucified on the cross and being raised on the third day from the dead be for a Yarabu, for people? Glory. What would it be?
It would be a testimony. It would be a testimony.
Yes. Yes. Why would it be a testimony?
Because they would hear about all the things that Jesus did, and they hear that he was crucified and then rose the next day, or then rose. It would be proof that it would be proof of God's power and God's
okay.
will.
Right. So now, Sherry, what happened when the people went to his grave and they didn't find anything there?
He was resurrected. The power, God resurrected him. What you mean by like what happened?
Yeah, what happened?
I mean, to Jesus.
What happened when the people found that he wasn't there in the grave?
Well, they believed that he was really the Son of God.
Why did they believe, though?
Because I probably have to go back and read it, but no, I don't want to say nothing, I'll be wrong.
Well, didn't he tell them that this was going to happen?
Yeah, he prophesied it.
Okay, that's it. So that's why his testimony is the spirit of prophecy.
Okay.
The testimony of Jesus on the cross, and he fulfilled the word that he told the people that he was coming back.
Mm-hmm.
It was fulfilled when he rose on the third day. Easter just passed.
Right.
So what happens is that we're not really understanding what's going on with the resurrection of Christ, because he prophesied it. Others prophesied it. It's not just one prophecy. And he fulfilled it. You see how my cup overflows? Because I fulfilled the word of God. If I don't fulfill the word of God, then I have no place in God, because there's no fulfillment in my life. If you write down full feel, you want to get full of the Holy Ghost and fill up the things that you're called to do, and that for others, helping others. So what he did is he was crucified, but it was a reason, because he needed for the people, God, our Father, needed for the people to see that death actually has no sting.
Mm-hmm.
If my son was raised from the dead, so can my children and my people. If my people, if they really see what's going on, and if they come unto me, if they confess that I am Lord of Lords and King of Kings, if they have the confession of Christ, see, they don't have death. They don't see death, because the resurrection of Christ is a testimony for others to take on and actually see that there's a prophetic word on your life that says you'll not die. Now, Revelation talks about it. Whenever the old man is changed to the new, death cannot have you, because now you belong to God. Your adoption of wit has come and taken place. The Gentiles received that back in Romans. You know, it was given to the Gentiles to acquire the adoption to wit. So what you find is that the Bible, if you read it from the New Testament, all of it actually, the New Testament, it has a path. And it takes the disciples on, because now they see Jesus fulfilling the word. They didn't believe that he was going to be raised, but now the word is fulfilled. Here's the word walking amongst us. It's talking to us, and no one knew it. That's in John 1. The word walked with us, the word talked with us, and we knew it not. The word. You see the emphasis on the word. Oh, it will come together, but it's very important to understand the cross. because the testimony was at the cross. He raised from the dead. See, everything that he was doing before, a lot of people are doing now. But what is happening is that the understanding of the testimony of Christ is not coming forth to really understand where the power is. See, the power was, it was raised when he raised from the dead. Resurrection power. How does that fit in our lives? In the intimate relationship with the Word. I see the Word differently because I know that Christ was raised from the dead. I've had an intimate relationship where he's showing me things that will come to pass. I see the Word in my life and other people's lives and testimonies coming to fulfillment because Christ is in it. The testimony of Christ is here. And so when people have no idea who they are, they belong to God. Therefore, the spirit of prophecy, it does not lie. Of course, we come in contact with, you know, some people or false prophets, and he says to weigh that. But we're talking about the prophet in us. Because if I believe and I understand the cross experience, what I know is that he says to take up your cross and follow me, right? Mm-hmm. And because he says, take up your cross and follow me, that means that I have to go through everything that he did. It may not be as impacting, but when my enemies sought to see me dead, glory, and they still, at some point, they see me get up and I'm walking around. They may not see me for a year or two, and God begins to show how great I am and that I'm still alive. They're saying, well, I thought she was dead. Oh, I thought she was done. No, the enemy couldn't have his way because I belong to God. The testimony on my life is that I shall live and not die. Amen?
Amen.
Any questions? I shall live and not die. And profess the word of the Lord. They are healed. The family is restored. You know, I have no more headaches. You know why? Because the testimony of God is in me. The prophecy is in me. The power is in me. Did I really confess Christ and say that I am a child of God? I believe that he died and raised from the dead. Did I just say it or do I believe it? Because see, if I believe it, the testimony begins to work in my life. Let's go to Romans 12. No, 10, I'm sorry. Connect it. You see, when you begin to actually see this here, you understand from the beginning to the end, you win. But it's your faith that's going to take you there. Because when you confess Christ, you didn't just do it because. Everybody had a reason why they did it. Did you do it because you were pressured into it? Or did you do it because you actually believe? Did you, you know, what was your reason? It's not a good or a bad thing. It's like looking at what's really happening here for yourself. And then you can understand better. No, I'm sorry. Man. Romans 9. You can understand better what it's all about because there's a lot of confusion in salvation. But if you don't believe or understand the testimony of Christ, you're going to lack some things. Everybody. And so I read these, and that's why it's expedient to study. If we have a class and you get a book, don't waste it not reading. Invest in yourself. Excuse me. Okay, Romans 9 and 10. Okay, and we'll start at 8, and it said, that is that they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God. So if you operate out of flesh, then you're not. It means you're speaking out of your flesh, you're not. You're thinking out of flesh, you're not. Get rid of that. But the children of the promise. And so many people talk about the promise. You are not getting a promise if you cannot understand Christ. You got, see, he obtained the promise. Why? Because he was sent for work, he did it, and he went on back. He did not get caught up in the people that didn't like him. He did not get caught up in the fact that they tried to say he was blaspheming. He just went on and just he dismissed all of those thoughts that people were putting on him. He wouldn't allow them to put him in bondage or to distract him from what he was called to do. So he acquires the promise. And it says, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. You remember back in Isaiah talks about your seed and your seed's seed, all right? For this is the word of promise. Read it and get the spirit behind it. As Paul says, the letter killeth, but the spirit brings life. You know why the letter kills? See, when you read, this is the letter. Just read it. For this is the word of promise. You have no understanding. You're still going to die. But when the spirit of prophecy comes, because you want to understand, you're earnest for learning, you will earn and receive that spirit of prophecy. You will understand and you will get the knowledge and wisdom and revelation the spirit is giving you. Why? Because you are earnest in your heart to receive what God is saying in his word. He's not merely saying, for this is the word of promise. He's saying that they that worship me must worship me in spirit and truth. John in 5, when he talked to the woman at Samaria at the well. No one will get access without spirit and truth. Why? Because human flesh cannot be trusted with the things of God. So many people are still reading like this, but this is the word of promise. At this time, I will come and Sarah shall have a son. Oh, Lord, I'm in the wrong one. It's 10. Sorry. Anyway, that's how they're reading it. I'm sorry. 10. Okay. So, but what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth. So he begins to talk about the word in your mouth again, and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Word of faith which we preach, that if thou confess with thy mouth that the Lord Jesus, the mouth that the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. See, if you believe that Jesus is raised from the dead, the testimony of his resurrection is the spirit of prophecy, because he fulfilled the word in his life. Then he says, let's see. For thine heart man believeth unto righteousness. With thine heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So you see what the mouth is doing in the beginning of your confession. You were prophesying. How many people on the line spoke their confession?
How many spoke our confession? You mean confess every day?
No, how many spoke the confession with their mouth when they gave their lives to Christ?
Oh, I did.
Okay.
Let me say this. Mm-hmm. I did, but I did it as a child. Because,
mm-hmm.
You know, back in my Baptist church, you know, that was how we was brought up to do this. You know, I didn't understand, but compared to what people are doing now, it's different when they confess.
Okay. Okay, this is good. I heard somebody else in the background. Okay, I guess not. All right. So it says, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So what we find here is that without our confessing with our mouth that we believe that the Lord Jesus was raised from the dead, we would not actually have salvation. So you see, again, this connects you with the prophetic. For the scripture says, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed, for there is no difference between the Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. So when you confess, when you speak, you declare, you decree, and you have had your confession as a person that believed in Christ and him being raised from the dead, what you're saying is you actually believe in the testimony of the spirit of prophecy, because you believe that he was raised from the dead. That's the spirit of prophecy. He fulfilled the word, and many people that have been brought to Christ confess Romans 9 through 10. But oftentimes they don't understand fully what they're doing. So God gives us the ability to look at the scriptures and actually begin to connect them. Because if you confess with your mouth that the Lord was raised from the dead, that what everybody did on Sunday last week, the resurrection of Christ, I think it was last Sunday, they believe in the spirit of prophecy. But unfortunately, this has not been revealed to many. Amen. So you have, again, the exercise that was on the spirit of prophecy to go over and earn to learn more. And we can go back into the next portion of this study next week. Amen. Amen. And so, Father God, we just thank you for your wisdom, your knowledge, and your revelation. And Lord, we thank you for the spirit of prophecy. We thank you even as we declare and decree that blind eyes be open and deaf ears to hear. We thank you, God, for even hearts being cleared to receive the fertile seeds that you've sown into us tonight. And we thank you for victory in every area of our lives. We thank you that as you move through the houses tonight, Lord God, that you give your people peace and rest, and that, Lord, you go out into the highways and byways by your spirit, even compelling your people to work in the vineyard and what you've called. For you said the harvest is great, but the workers are few. And so, God, we thank you for compelling workers in the vineyard. Thank you, God, for your spirit sending out the blood of Jesus and angels to bring a level of protection to the earth, and even to the people and the families that have lost loved ones, Lord. We just pray, Lord God, that you would touch them and heal them in the name of Jesus, and that, Lord, even though you showing us the things that are coming, that you would come back real soon and make a turnaround regarding the losses of lives and bring increase in the lives of God. In the name of Jesus, we thank you for covering our families and those that we are connected with. And we thank you, Lord God, that you use us as people of salvation, that we go in and we begin to confess who you are, and that others' lives will be changed because of this, and that our light is shining bright because of you, Lord God, in us. We thank you that no weapon formed against any of us shall prosper, and that, Lord, we live in the land of living, and we shall continue to profess your name in the mighty name of Jesus, that you're loosening shackles tonight, and you're calling forth breakthrough in families in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You guys have a wonderful evening.
Amen.